And I guess the Golden Valley House is on the agenda, but I had a call from someone who wants to rent that for 3 or 4 months. They're doing renovation on their house. And what our rental price would be.
Is that under other business?
Well, I don't know if we can do it under.
Under deeds?
We can talk about it then.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's just do it then.
Anything else? If not, can we have a motion to approve the agenda as amended?
So move.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Wayne, how do you vote?
I'll vote aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
And I vote aye. Motion carried. Approval of the minutes of the July 9th, 2018 meeting.
Chairman, I make a motion we approve the minutes as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Any questions on the minutes? Any questions? Gary, how do you vote?
I vote aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wayne?
I vote aye.
And I vote aye. Motion carried. Approval of the regular bills.
Thirty-six is the portable radios. That's, we're going to talk about that. So are we going to approve it to pay it now, or are we going to wait until after Dean is here, or what?
Well, I don't know what the end date is on the invoice. This is the second time it's been on.
Third.
And we probably should approve it, and we can ask the questions to the sheriff when he gets here.
Is he going to be here today?
I have no idea. He's on the agenda.
She's on the agenda. I'd like to ask her what this jackets, vests, gloves, hard hats, what that was all for.
That's Jim Elmer's. That's risk management.
Oh. Do you know what?
It looks like it'd be County Road.
That bill from Train that we tabled last time, that is not part of the courthouse and jail expansion. That's other maintenance, so we'd have to approve that as well. And that also for number 28, Cofiles Plumbing and Heating. That is, you know, like spare parts for the boiler, work on the water mixing valve. That's not part of the building project as well.
Well, that troubleshoot the boardroom, how can that? That wasn't an issue before this was tied in, was it? Number 74?
It's part of the maintenance and stuff for the old courthouse here is what it is. So it's not part of the building project. The HVAC unit.
train bill?
I guess, we got an answer, so.
I did talk to him before the meeting about it, and, you know, that's what he said, isn't it? It wasn't part of the building project, so, but if you want him to come in, I guess, it's up to you guys.
Well, I'd like to know what 55 is for.
We can hold him and I can grab him on recess and then again.
And, on the new sheet, the one that was today, 14, that's the one that they just finally bought that?
Yep, they traded in the 16.
New four-wheel? I thought they had it earlier.
Oh, the weed board.
Or the weed board, I mean?
On the new sheet, or the new shipment today, this morning.
Well, okay. Anyhow, this one here, just if you could, if you want me to explain it a little, or take some time. Anyhow, the one they had about 2,300 miles on it. The last meeting, they had, the thing blew up the radiator twice. Instead of going to the overflow, it just blew the radiator. And he put a new cap on and it blew the radiator again. Well, that wasn't the only issue with it. All of a sudden, it gets to jumping out of gear, and they checked with them guys how to set the linkage. And here, the output shaft back in by the gearbox, you could wiggle it, the bearing is out. So they talked with the dealer, and the dealer basically said, well, X amount of dollars, I'll trade this. This was 2 years old, I'll trade that model in. And then this was the difference, wherever that is, right? Of getting a new model up, and they were upfront with what's wrong with it, and so the board decided to get her traded off. And
there was money to cover that? Now, didn't they get a new one?
They got a new one in January.
So
yeah, there was money to cover that.
So they're both new now.
Both basically new now, yeah. So we traded it in and had her peeled off, and within a day he had the tanks and everything on and ready to go again. But they just discussed how, what do we do? We're gonna have a bill here of probably $3,000. And they couldn't figure out why it blew up, you know, it'd get pressure and just blow up that radiator.
No, that was the Can-Am
that
they were having trouble with?
Yeah. So in a nutshell, that's...
Well, can we have a motion to approve the regular bills?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any other questions? Any other questions? Wayne, how do you vote?
Vote aye.
Gary?
I vote aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Dwight?
No.
And I vote aye. Motion carried. Approval of the treasurer bills?
I make a motion to approve them.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any questions on those? Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Wayne?
I vote aye.
Gary?
Aye.
And I vote aye. Motion carried. Darby, you're up next. The pledges of assets.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, on that sheet there, the one that says for Mercer County cash investment and June 30th, 2018. That total there, $3,003.391, that is the money that is left in the bank. For CDs and cash in the bank. As of June 30th. I'm just making you guys aware of that.
And that, for the less for the insurance.
FDIC insurance.
Yeah. Okay. And that's held in the bank then too, or?
Well, we just have, they have to supply $250,000.
Oh.
You know, it's just a formula to make sure they have pledged enough.
To cover.
To cover what's in the bank. And the first $250,000 of pledging is their responsibility. I mean, actually, it's all theirs, but we deduct that from that amount and then it's 110% of the amount in the bank that they have to pledge for. They actually like it when there's not so much money in the bank.
Yeah,
yeah, of course.
Any other questions?
Do we have a motion to approve the pledge of assets?
I so move.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any other questions for Darby? Any other questions?
So this $3.3 million, that's what we got left to spend till the end of the year? Wow.
There is. That's gone. I don't know what you guys are going to do.
Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wayne?
I'll vote aye.
And I'll vote aye. Motion carried.
Dan, you want a copy of that?
Go on to other business, game and fish resolution for no wake on Missouri River.
Did you guys all get a chance to review that?
I did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll make a motion that we approve the resolution for the no wake zone in the Missouri River in conjunction with McLean County.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any other questions on that resolution?
Just to clarify this, this does not include the upper part of the dam, right? It's just the Missouri River part. It does not include, up on the Garrison Dam. That's core property.
It goes north to where the spillway enters the Missouri River.
Right, yeah.
Now, that's not to say that there isn't one coming for the lake, too.
seconded that.
Gary did.
Gary did, yeah.
Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wayne?
I'll vote aye.
And I'll vote aye, motion carried. Next, we have the June sheriff's fees of $5,932.68. We have a motion for approving that?
So move.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Wayne, how do you vote?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Gary?
I vote aye.
And I vote aye, motion carried. Next, we have the June recorder's fees, $6,120.50.
I make a motion we approve the recorder's fees.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Gary, how do you vote?
Aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wayne?
I'll vote aye.
And I'll vote aye, motion is carried. Dean, you're up next.
Good morning.
Morning.
Morning. How we doing?
Good.
Good. Wayne?
Aye, Dean.
Haven't seen you in a while, Dan.
Well, I guess you're on the agenda for update on the jail radios and the house in Golden Valley.
Oh, sure.
I guess, Dean, we just had a question on, you know, on the radios and, you know, of all the equipment. I'm assuming it was in your budget. Is that, if you want to just kind of...
Well, we put communications in the budget. We don't know what we're going to use. Now, in this case, you know, for about a year, when we're doing a construction project, the old analog radios were interfering with the cameras. It would not penetrate the new walls. Anytime the analog radios would pop up, the screens would black out in the control room. So we talked about that during the construction project several times, how we could fix that. Well, basically what they came up with at one point in time was in the 50,000 something range, they wanted to put a repeater system in, wanted to put in polling stations, which is little antennas throughout the building, but still did not fix the blacking out of the cameras. So then we went into putting a new frequency in the radio, which was $20,000+, to put in an analog frequency in a new in the old radios, in the dispatch center. Well, that was ridiculous, I thought. Why would we spend $50,000 and then $20,000+? And then I called Team Electronics, or Electronic Communications, when they were doing our update on the software. And Arnie came up, and they had the same problem in Burley County with their new jail. So what they did was did a study with different digital radios. So we came up, they brought some digital radios up here, and we used those for a week to see if they would work. And then Arnie could actually just put that new frequency in our current radio, in our dispatch radios. So at that cost was about, what, $5,800, $900 to do that, because we had no communications in the back or in this area with the old analog radios at all. So we had to update those. There was no choice in the matter. Either that or put in, you know, like I said, put in tens of thousands of dollars, which didn't make any sense to me. when it was just a frequency issue going from analog to digital. But that was, oh, I suppose a whole year about of when they started putting the new cameras and such in that we had a problem with that. It took that long to come up with an issue, with a solution.
So basically, I mean, today it works. You
yep.
got communications throughout the whole system.
Yep. Yep, now and it doesn't
block
anything out or do any of the frequency, doesn't distort any of the communications.
And you'd be updated, and I'm assuming when state radio, you know, when they do the new towers and stuff throughout the state or whenever that happens, or?
Well, that's going to be, you know, that's still a fight that we're having, the sheriff's, of whether or not we need to have that. If they go into the polling stations across the across North Dakota, none of us are going to be up to date. None of us. Mm-hmm. And that's been my biggest fight because there's no. My opinion is, and a lot of us, our opinion is that they should update their towers with the current frequencies they have. You know, they've been after our frequencies for 10 years. Well, more than that, when Dick was here.
And that's state radio now.
Yeah,
okay.
And they've been after all of our frequencies. We switched them over many, many years ago. They belong to us, the frequencies. There's only so many frequencies that the FCC gives out. And this is what they're doing here is really no benefit to us. Some of the areas, like small counties, are still relying on state radio for dispatching, you know, and they'll have no choice in the matter because they're not big enough. They can't, they don't have, you know, enough people to have a dispatch center of their own. But, you know, I don't think it's necessary. And they're using the DAPL business. We had a tower issue down south of Mandan when all that DAPL business was going on. And it basically was because they didn't maintain it for so many years because they weren't really using it. So when we needed to use it, it didn't work. You know, and the tower is $1 million or more to deal with that. But, and that's still, I just got, you know, an email today or yesterday regarding that. And it doesn't help this the bigger areas like Mandan or Bismarck or Fargo or any of those places. They already have their own complete system. They don't even talk on state radio. Only supervisors can switch over to state radio. Not the you know the other 300 cops in Bismarck or whatever can't switch over to state radio. So they have their own dispatch center. So they don't care because it's not going to affect them. Affect us.
So this was just for in-house here, pretty much?
Yep.
So it works now?
Yep. Works good. We tried it for a whole week before we even got any, and we had to get rid of the old analog radios. Well, we're going to use them. The analog radios are going to switch over to the dive team because we didn't have any. Our old radios we got from DGC 16 years ago finally died, you know? They were old and we got them. But so we took those other analog radios because we needed to replace those and we're using those in the dive rescue trailer for the, you know, communications with it.
Did we have to pay a separate license for this particular channel?
Nope. It's a business band channel.
Okay.
So we didn't have to pay it. And we don't have to pay licensing fees for the FCC because we're a government entity.
Okay.
But this was a business band channel. Digital business plan, and then we could put it right into, and the extra $800 or whatever was for Arnie and his guys to put that radio right, that frequency right in our dispatch center so the dispatchers and the control room don't have to go get a portable radio. They can just switch over and push the mic and talk to the correctional officers or security at any time.
Any other questions for Dean on the radios?
Yeah, why, if these radios were a
the direct result of the expansion, why weren't they in the expansion budget?
Didn't know anything about it. We had no clue that this was gonna happen at all. In the planning stage, nobody ever said that we need to put in radios because you're gonna, the old analog radios are going to distort the cameras and mess with the frequency in the control room. Not once. No idea. But there, I mean, there's many things like that.
Yeah, we're not done by far.
So.
That I know.
Any other questions on the radio concern? If not, we'll talk a little bit about the house in Golden Valley.
Mm-hmm.
What's the plan there?
Well, I don't have any plan. You know, we had it when Paul moved there, and then he moved out, of course. And I just don't see getting rid of it yet. You know, we're short-staffed right now. No applicants. We did have one person that was interested in moving there that was a correctional officer, but he got a job at GGC. Now, I don't know. I just saw last week where some of the people on probation were let go. But he hasn't applied. I don't know if he's the person that got let go or not. I think he's working for security out there. And I don't know if they have their own security or if that's contracted or what. I guess I don't know.
Now, you're using the Wi-Fi that's in that house?
That was when he set it up a long time ago. Is what the deputies do when they're out in the Golden Valley area is they can hook up to the internet out there and do all their paperwork, so which gets sent back here to the office. Now everything we do anymore with the all of our reports, calls for service, our car crashes, everything is internet based. All of it. I mean, everything has to be uploaded here. It has to be sent to Bismarck that way. You can't make a copy anymore and send it to them.
Just a question here, Dean.
What's that?
Just a question here.
Sure.
The mayor in Golden Valley was wondering why you don't hook up to the Wi-Fi at City Hall.
Well, and here's the problem. That's why we don't let the guys hook up to the Wi-Fi at their home. Because all that is open to public records. Okay, and if you have an issue with your Wi-Fi out there, your issue with your internet, what's going to happen? You're going to come back and is it our fault to do it? That's why we have our own, especially with paperwork and whatnot. And some of that stuff is confidential. I don't know. You want it on your system? I don't know how that exactly how it works.
Is that different Wi-Fi than they have at City Hall?
Well, ours is secured in our own frequency, our own IP address. Each one has one. Everybody's different, you know. But it's always been. And I said, if we want to get rid of it, they'll just have to go back to the office or come in on their day off to upload their stuff. I mean, that's the way it is.
Well, you know, I guess, Dean, one of the thoughts is, you know, budget's going to be really tight this year. You know, and then we have somebody go up taking care of the yard, and, you know, it's all extra. And we really would like to sell it, if at all possible. We'd like to, you know, get rid of the home and
well,
along with the school and.
I get that. You know, you got a lot of properties. I think, and we are in that process in the last year of having issues hiring people. And that may be one of those things that's used for a draw, that we can give you a temporary housing while you're here, because you're not getting anybody from around here that are applying for jobs at all. And I used it last time with, like I said, I was talking about that kid that moved up here. Said, hey, you know, we can give you a place to live. It's $450 a month. You can't beat that. You know, you pay that. And it was in negotiation for that. And then he went on to DGC. You know, I suppose, well, more money, obviously, more benefits, all those types of things. Like I said, we have one opening, no, two openings. I anticipate here shortly we're going to have three openings. In the jail portion.
Now moving on with this, I had a call from resident in Golden Valley that would like to rent that for like 3 or 4 months.
Why not?
That is going to renovate, major renovations and addition to their house.
Sure.
And it's the fire chief in Golden Valley and he's on city council. And he was asking if I would bring it to the commission and see if he could rent that for a short period of time.
I don't know why not.
And what the rent would be.
That's up to you guys. We did charge $450, what we were charging the deputy, you know, but it's no issue with me. I just hate to get rid of it and take a loss on it, and then we're back to not having a place. Maybe paid about $80,000 for it, I think. $83,000 for it.
Well, if this sets empty, it doesn't do no good either.
Well, I agree with you.
How can somebody else rent it if we have this secure Wi-Fi?
I'd have to shut it off. Or they wouldn't have the access to it. I guess they wouldn't have the password or anything.
Well, then, at the Wi-Fi at the city hall, if it's password protected, why wouldn't that Wi-Fi work?
We're back to, I didn't want to have anything to do with another entity of any information going through. And we're, like I said, we're back to that with anything with what we do anymore is open to open records requests.
Well, since they contract with you for policing and allow your people to use the office whenever they need to, couldn't that be set up for secure?
Maybe we could. I don't know. And that was the idea a long time ago why we switched that, was not to be have Golden Valley involved in any of our reports and things. That's just gotten the way it is anymore. Like I said, I don't let the guys use their stuff at home at all. And I didn't want, and usually what happens is, and this happens with like Paul and with Ryan in particular, is they live in Beulah and live in, you know, between Zap and Golden Valley. So they usually make their last round before going home after their shift in the Golden Valley area. Zap. So they do their reports, they go home.
Well, could you check into it if you have so we could get rid of the property, you know.
Is there Wi-Fi at the Beulah office?
Yeah. Yeah. And they use that too when they do the Beulah. No, I mean, yeah, at the Beulah, our office?
Yeah.
Yeah, we use the Michelle's, you know, which is part of us. They use
so
Beryl.
It could be done there. They wouldn't have to come here to the office.
And I put that in the budget. I said we can take that out of there. Mm-hmm. I did knock that off. I said, we'll just have to come up with a different plan. They'll have to go back to Beulah and do that. I mean, if that's an issue, the, I don't know, it's $450 a year or whatever.
Do you have a place in Zap?
No.
Well, if we decide to rent that out for a few months, we'll have a few months to decide if we're going to sell it or not, I guess.
And you see the difference, you know, right now, if you watch in our western states, is western counties, is the oil traffic is picked up considerably. And Dunn County, McKenzie County are back in the same spot again where they're losing staff that's going to work in oil field. And the oil companies, you know, which I know a few of them, are being very particular now of who they hire. They're not hiring the people that are transient workers from Oklahoma and that sort of thing. They're trying to pick people from the area and giving them jobs with benefits, you know, which used to be money before. And I think we're going to get in, and we did get in that issue. We're into it right now. Like I said, getting people up here. And to me, that was it. And I said that to Jim and to Colin, is our negotiation, even if we lose a deputy. Negotiation factor is to get somebody a place to live as soon as possible to get them established here. But
well,
we can
rent,
cut out the cost per month.
If we rent it out for a few months and a situation came up, after that, the rental agreement would still be available.
Right. Yeah. No, I have no issue with that. I mean, fire chief and whatnot.
I guess that's my thought too. Let's rent it out, see how it goes.
Yeah.
And then after the rental is over with, we can reevaluate it.
Yeah. And that's somebody that's local that we know, that's not gonna cause any trouble.
Well, he's on the city council and
Right, that's what I mean.
Fire chief, so I don't.
It's not some transients.
So you're making a motion to rent it, at what?
Yeah, I guess before I do that, I just wanna, you know, if that works for you, Dean, let's try this, and then in the meantime, maybe you can look at some other avenues, and I guess just really try hard to help us cut our budget.
I did, I already took it out.
It's really tight, so.
I told her she could go ahead and disconnect it, but we don't have to disconnect electricity, you know?
Cause if you took it out already, what were you going to do in place of that?
Go to Sepulveda, go to Beulah. What's that?
That was for next year.
Yeah, why didn't you turn it off today, Beulah?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we lease out the Golden Valley home for $450 per month, until the individual does not need it anymore, and in the meantime, we'll evaluate the situation, and, after that point, we can decide what we wanna do.
Subject to finalizing a lease with some individual?
Yes, yeah, yeah, yeah. Does that have to be done through Shoshana or you, or?
Both of us.
Both, okay.
Okay, you know the name of the even individual, Shoshana Kenton? Yes, you'll have to ask him, I guess, if that price is okay with him.
Then he just needs to get ahold of me.
Pardon?
Then he just needs to get ahold of me.
Yeah, I'll contact him, I guess. I don't know when this would start, probably next month, you know, I don't know. I'll have to have him call you and set it up, I guess.
We need a second.
Pardon?
We need a second.
Yes. Is there a second to Wes's motion?
Yeah, I'll second.
Any other questions?
I don't know, I've heard before that Mercer County isn't in the housing business, and, if we rent it out for 3 or 4 months, then it's winter, and we're gonna end up heating it all winter. So I'm not against renting it out, but I think it should be put up for sale now.
Well, I guess the thought behind my motion was to, that'll give Dean a chance to look for other avenues and, you know, see if we can make it work, you know, so that was the thought behind that.
I think we heated that before, right?
Yeah.
We heated that in the winter time before.
It'd be just as simple as draining all the water and setting heat up. It's like any other house, you have to do that, water heaters and such.
But y'all, you know, you normally gotta have a little heat in there, you can't let it.
And the other thing.
It's not good for it.
You got sheet rock issues and you've got moisture issues, so you wanna run it around 40 degrees, I mean.
Agree with you.
Yeah, you don't.
And the other thing, Dean, you know, check it out in a month or so, if you decide you don't need it, come back to us and we can put it up for sale then. We don't have to wait till the lease agreement's over with too, so I agree with Dwight on that situation too, so.
You know, like I said, it's like anything else, we own it, it's paid for, the way the market is right now, you're gonna get $80,000 for it, or no. And so what, we're gonna take it for a loss and then I need it in 3 months, 4 months. And I think it really, right now, is that I'm having difficulties with hiring people, and I've been using that as a negotiation tool for a temporary deal, because everybody's coming from out of the area. I have 4 people that don't live here.
I mean, we did make some improvements, we put a new roof on his house, you know, but maybe this short-term lease here would.
Give us some time.
Give us a little bit of time and also recoup a little bit of the money.
Right. And if somebody, like I said, somebody we know, and he's a
right.
firefighter or council member, we don't have a chance of anything getting destroyed or anything like that.
Well, Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
Dwight?
No.
Wayne?
I'll vote aye.
And I'll vote aye, motion is carried.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask Dean one, just one other question? This is not on the agenda, but it refers to your department, I guess, but I've been getting calls back in Beulah from the local fire department. They're saying that there's a rescue squad possibly coming over to Beulah, that they had visited with you about either moving Hazen's rescue squad over or starting another one, or is it a rumor that we can clear up, or?
Well, we talking about it, it's on the agenda, or what are we doing? Because it was on the budget discussion.
It is in the budget?
Well, no.
We'll discuss it during budget.
Discussion at budget time. But to clarify, if you want to clarify, it is not taking anything away from Hazen at all. But it's been discussion for 10 years or better regarding it, having to.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Well, thanks, Dean, I think that's.
Yeah, thanks for coming in.
Only two items on the agenda for you.
Have a good day.
Okay, we'll go back to the other business, monthly financial statement. Has everybody had a chance to review that?
Mr. Chairman, I see Jim is here. Will we have time to get Jim in real quick? Dwight had some questions for Jim to make with the bills.
Oh, okay.
What are these? There was a bill to Menards, safety jackets, vests, gloves, hard hats.
That was for safety gear for the county shop. They needed some more extra gear and stuff to update their supply.
For the county shop?
Yep. I buy that through risk management, the safety supplies. So Ken and Elroy picked that up at Menards, from what I understand, so.
So it all went, all this stuff went to the county shop?
Yep.
That's all I wanted to know.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thanks, Jim. Monthly financial statement. No action is required, or any questions?
Shannon, with the percentages wise, is it about on target then for the year? Or I know some are probably over, but there's a lot that are under, but I mean overall average? What you know what the percentage should be about now, at the end of July?
50.
Okay.
Oh, end of July. This is the end of June.
Though. End of June,
so,
so
it should be
50%.
This health insurance, Shanna, that's at 65% for the year. Is that because do we have more people hired? Are we paying health insurance for more people?
A few more, and then we budget the 1.2 million.
Yeah.
That's our max stop loss. So we won't ever spend more than the 1.2 million in a year. But as people say, you have high dollar claims in January until individuals hit 10,000 each. You pay all the claims on them. So say you went to the doctor, had a major knee surgery, and you hit 12,000 in January, then you can let your stop loss for the year. So we won't accrue any more bills on you for the rest of the year, but it you know, depends on how many hit stop loss. In the past, we had like 7, and now it's up to like closer to 20 that hit their stop loss every year. So it's just, we've had a lot of high dollar claims.
So how many more people are we insuring? You, what?
I probably like 4 or 5
okay.
employees. You know, I couldn't tell you the difference.
Well, that does, that's.
Single or whatever, but, yeah. And that stop loss goes for each person on the plan. So if there's a family of five, all five people have to get their $10,000 stop loss before we stop paying them. I believe we're up to 68 full-time health plans, or full-time employees taking both.
Well, it don't look to me like that one's gonna make it.
Yeah, we'll hit the max, and then it'll be done.
Well, you hit the max, but didn't we amend some health insurance on the budget from last year? So we went over that 1.2 million last year? So it don't necessarily stop at 1.2 million.
It should be right close, though, because when Blue Cross Blue Shield gives me the paperwork for the following year, it's not until October, and we do budgets in July. This year, I did bump it up to 1.4 million.
Okay, Cindy, you're up next.
Okay, this is temporary use permit number 523. This application is for Coteau Properties for a temporary use permit to drill test holes for coal exploitation and monitoring well installation. The sites are located in Section 6, Township 145 North, Range 85 West, Section 31, Township 146 North, Range 85 West, Section 1, 2, 3, 10, 11, and 12, Township 145 North, Range 86 West, Section 35 and 36, Township 146 North, Range 86 West, of the 5th Principal Meridian, Mercer County, North Dakota, and Sarah Flath is present today to answer any questions from the board.
These are the same as the large map, but
sure.
You can kind of unfold them and either keep them in your files for reference or follow along whenever you like. Pink is just so highly visible, but it's fun. I guess to give you a brief overview, once I easel repositioned. Can you guys see this somewhat? We're requesting the temporary use permit to do drilling. There's two types of drilling we'd be looking at doing, both monitoring well installation, and there were attachments to the temporary use permit that listed the location legals for each monitoring well. Of those, there's 16 monitoring wells. 15 of the 16, the locations we're looking at putting them would be in a section line right away. So some are on developed section lines, so it'd be in like a developed improved road ditch, and then about half of them are undeveloped section lines, but they would all be within the right of way of the section line. And the reason why we try to put those monitoring wells in the road right of way is when possible, and we've done this at other mining locations in the county. The reason why we do that is because those monitoring wells are kept throughout the mining process. And so we are able to monitor what groundwater is doing in the aquifers that are listed in the attachments to the permit. So it'd be the aquifers above, within the coal seam that we're removing, and then below that coal seam. And so at each of the locations that are circled, that either have the dark blue or light blue circles, there's 3 to 4 monitoring wells at each of those locations. And that's just to target each of those 3 to 4 aquifers that are in that location near our coal seam. And then
that's actually just right north of where you had mined previously, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Which is actually tie into that, wouldn't it?
Yes, it'd be north and east. We did 1 mile to the south of here. We did 1 mile east of County Road 27. So this section was mined, and then this section was mined. And then this would be just kind of to the northeast. And so I was kind of starting to allude to the thing that's unique about this application is we're still in the process of leasing, getting the surface leases on this area that we're looking at expanding into with our mining. And we have some of it leased. That would be indicated by the circles around the monitoring wells that are light blue. And we're still pursuing leases on the others. Some we're getting close on, negotiations are ongoing. And so I kind of discussed options with Colette previously when we submitted this application on how should we do this. Should we submit one application now only for the areas that we have surface control, in other words, that we have leases in place, and then as we get either access agreements from surface owners or leases, do we come back one, two, however many times yet this year as those leases or access agreements trickle in? I am proposing, and we'll see if U.S. commissioners are comfortable with this, to simplify the process. We submit this one application. If we got approval for it, the whole area, there would be a condition attached to this approval that we couldn't go anywhere until we provided your offices with a copy of either the lease or the access agreement to demonstrate that we have the rights to be on that land. I did speak with Jessica and made sure that was okay. I don't know if you have anything to add.
No, I think that'd be fine. I told her I think the options are to, one, make it conditional on approval from the landowners and it's null and void until such time. Two would be to piecemeal which ones have already approved and approved or already have the access to approve those, or deny it entirely subject to getting all of it pulled together. But I don't see a problem in conditioning it on that. We do conditions a lot, and until that condition is met, it's null and void. So I get what she's saying and trying to simplify this. So
yeah, I just have one question.
Sure.
Just to you have not gone to PSC yet with this, or where are you at on that process? You don't go there until after you get all the all the landowners.
The other step is when we apply to a permit to the PSC, we need about 2 years worth of environmental data that includes groundwater information, which is why we're doing the groundwater monitoring wells. And so this would start that process of data collection. This
okay.
would be one piece in that. We also would submit the drilling results from the exploration drilling. So there'd be drilling results in that permit application, the coal, and then the dirt above it, the overburden above it. And so this is about 2 years before we're able to submit that permit application.
Okay. Then it'd probably be another, 2 years after that before you get to mining it, or?
Well, just kind of to give the commissioners an idea of the timeline, our goal would be to start severing coal from here in 2025. And so we do development work a year ahead of time, save topsoil and subsoil, and get the areas set up for that. The other thing, I don't know if the commissioners have thought of this or not, the other thing, of course, is County Road 27. We want to, of course, keep that open. And so we'd be looking at putting a bridge structure that similar to County Road 21, not that same style, but we would need a bridge to make sure we can keep County Road 27 open. We wouldn't be looking at a detour or anything like that.
Sarah, what is the intent on County Road 37 that goes through there?
At this time, it's pretty early, but if we did secure all the leases that we're pursuing, we're able to mine through it, we would mine through it and have to do, depending on what was happening with the people that live in that area, there's a lot of unknowns yet. We're very early in the process. So if the people that, these are occupied residents, if they did decide to lease and they decided to
mine coal, or lease is just for the, to get on there to drill hole, test hole?
The leases I'm referring to because of what's going on here, the surface leases, and, you know, we're pursuing both surface and mineral leasing in this area. But to do the data collection that we need for the environmental data collection and for the geologic data collection, that's surface leases to get on the surface, and so that's what we're still in the process, where the dark blue circles are unleased, and we don't know if we'll, realistically, will we get those in time to drill this year? We don't know.
So it's just more surface damage to, for the test holes?
Yep.
And that will determine whether you want to lease the land for mine.
Right, and to give you an idea what those test holes are like, mold drilling does them, you know, out of EULA. It's not that different than, say, drilling a water well. But they do pull up a core that we can collect information from and send to the lab.
What's that little L shape in the middle there? Why?
That, good question. That is coal where the mineral is owned by the federal government, and that takes a federal exploration permit for that before we can drill on there. And because it's the federal government, just to get that permit, it takes longer than a year and lots of paperwork, and you can't apply till you have the surface leased. And so that's usually when we're doing this type of exploration drilling, we start off by doing private mineral owners, and then when we know more where our permit boundary will be, and we know, okay, this tract is surrounded by good coal, now it's worth jumping through the federal hoops to fill in the blanks in what we know about the coal reserve.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the permit on the condition that the landowners, edits lease to the landowners. And if not, then it's void, null and void.
Okay.
Yeah.
The one other thing I was going to add is we are pursuing leases, but another option is for surface access. Instead of leasing the surface for mining, we can also get on there, and we're pursuing with some people a surface access agreement.
So I think it would be secure landowner access.
Okay.
Whether it would be easement or access agreement, but secure landowner access.
Thank you for helping me out with that.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions for Sarah? Any other questions? Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Gary?
I vote aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wayne?
I'll vote aye.
And I'll vote aye. Motion carried. Thanks, Cindy.
Thank you.
Next up is the Highway Department.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to close the bid for the bid letting.
Is there a second on that motion?
Second.
Wes, how do you vote?
I vote aye.
Wayne?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Gary?
I vote aye.
I vote aye. Motion carried.
How are you doing?
Said she wanted me to. Good morning, guys.
Morning.
It appears that we had two bids for the countywide patching and striping. I guess I'll just go right ahead here, and then I'll open it up and get the bond over to Jessica. This one right here is from Northern Improvement Company. They acknowledge the addendum. Okay, total base bid for Northern Improvement Company, $298,356.12, 298,356.12.
Detailed out as to what these contractors need to do.
Yep. This is not quite sure who this is from yet. It's a mystery package. There you go. Okay, bituminous paving.
You know them guys? Yeah.
He probably owns part of it.
I've seen any of the trucks.
Okay, yeah. You're right. I just couldn't remember.
No.
Good to go. Okay, bituminous paving. Total base bid of $391,270.52. 391,270.52.
It is a big difference.
What's the engineer's estimate?
I don't have it in front of me, but it was right around 287. So I think with that is what we'll do is I'll have to do the math on the bids, and then maybe we'll talk about it because it does exceed the a little bit, and see what we can do to probably come back to the next meeting and ask for award at that time, probably.
Just to update us or these projects where they're all going to be at again. I mean, just to refresh our memories. It would be 2025 and no.
It's been been so long since I looked at it. We got
Golden Valley.
Yep.
Gone by there, Golden Valley, and then up by coming off of Highway 200 up by west of Big City, where it goes up in those cabin sites out of the corner. There's a spot there. And then the striping.
The striping is this countywide, a lot of different striping going on. Mm-hmm. But the patching is kind of scattered and
so this patching, they actually take out a chunk of pavement, or they just...
Yep.
They do.
Yep, that was all part of the plans, yep.
Okay, well, put that on the agenda for the...
I need a motion.
Okay, let's have a motion to do that.
I move to table the bids until next meeting.
So they have a chance to review.
Review the bids, yeah.
Is there a second?
I can second that.
Wayne, how do you vote?
I'll vote aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
And I vote aye, motion carried. Okay, we'll go back to the regular meeting. Outstanding road accounts?
I don't have any, they're outstanding in my current list of Do you have any, Sean?
These have all been taken care of then?
No, I don't get that list.
Well, I think you get those 30 days, don't you?
Right, but I don't have we just have what people, there's nothing to do on the rest of the list of yesterday. So I mean, they were billed, but this is all the time.
They're not past due.
Right.
They're not past due.
Right.
Because there's quite a few of them, there's, looks like quite a few of them are overloads or wide load.
I don't know, I didn't.
These are all, these are not overloads.
I don't get that list.
No, yeah.
I would just, yeah, I don't know what.
Well, there's one, two, three of them from Knife River, that's why I'm asking what they would be for.
Oh, yeah, that's what that was for when they moved that down into South Haven. But they're not past due yet, they're still, I mean, they still have some
Yeah, but it was for over with or overload permits or whatever?
Yep.
Okay, that's what I'm asking.
Yep.
Not non-compliant permits, yeah.
Just regular permits to get them in and out, yep, that's what it was.
You have ag permits, is that your?
Ag permits, we only have two, we have that deal where we, I think Wayne was on board back then when we did that countywide, if you have land in Mercer County, to get ag permits to go from an 80,000 pounds to 90,000 pounds on the county roads that are labeled as such, and, except for during frost laws, but like I say, we only have two current ag permits out there, so I'm just making it aware that, you know, I mean, sure there's more than just two people that are hauling over 80,000 pounds in the county, and that counts in commercial too. This is two just at the, not the commercial ag, but we have some of them in town too, or in the county too, so I don't know what's, you know, we could put it out there as far as in the press that you remember your ag permits, but I don't know what is the best way to do it other than enforcement, I'm thinking, because how can you else, can you get the word out there, because I don't know.
Is there a response, is there a somebody's responsibility to make that there is such a thing as ag permits, or?
Well, sheriff's department's the one that would have to issue a
They would issue if they were overloaded or whatever.
Yeah, I can't do anything.
Right, I was just asking who's.
You know, I guess in the past, you know, the, you know, getting close to harvesting time and stuff, they usually come in and start getting their ag permits, so a lot of your larger producers, they know that. But it maybe wouldn't be a bad idea, I guess that would be my thought, is just put an ad in the paper, just remind them, and that way they can't say they didn't know. I mean, like, kind of like what go through with the road restrictions as well.
Have there been very many citations this year for overloads, or?
I think I only got, I think two at the most, and that was during frost laws, or I think it's actually
That was during frost laws? A lot of trucks running around out there.
I mean, we can put a deal on the thing, but I, you know, make sure they get them, because, yeah, because there's guys harvesting winter wheat already, you know.
Anything else, Ken?
Just another thing, I had a couple calls late last week about a section line west of County 11, where that gas valve is, Wayne, you know where it's at.
Yep.
DGC has a gas valve about a mile west of County 11 between Ralph Beavers and Ramona Johnson.
Right.
And if you go back there, you go a mile west, you go south, and well, a little over a mile, there's some state land back there.
Right.
There's a half a section. It's private on both sides of that north.
yet, I think it's all been 3 or 4 years when we started having all that rain, it washed out part of that section line, and they had made the request if we could put a, improve that back there so they can get back there for fire, because you can't. RGA Warner has some property back there,
right.
It's private, I mean, it's out in the middle of nowhere, really, and to get to it, you almost have to go through this location. Well, last fall, I had one of my blade operators, DGC, had asked if they could, if we could blade that to that gas
well.
Belt.
Yeah.
And when he got down to that west end, there was a gate across it with a padlock on it.
I bet you it's
not. But here's the thing, my question is, you know, the people that we're supposed to open this up for the state land back there, and for a while, you know, wildland fire protection, but yet it's gated across in the fall of the year. So, I mean, are we treating it as a private or a public deal here? You know, I mean.
Well.
Who's locked,
yeah.
And then.
Well, I'm
the
assured.
Neighbors do too.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I'm assured that one little call to law enforcement.
Well, that's
the,
right.
But
the, and I
confronted. He can probably
individual.
Gate it, but he cannot lock that up. I mean, that's
yeah,
got to go.
It was locked.
Yeah.
My blade operator is back all the way up. Quarter mile to get into our approach and turn around. So, and at that time, I probably should have let, you know, but it's like, and
because it
from
should
what
have
I've heard, it happens every year because we only have to get that gas valve. So they
because it's access to the, there's a state of North Dakota land, and we know what the Century Code says. So if this happens again, just send somebody the
yeah.
deal and.
Yeah, we can do that.
Right.
But just to inform the commission board, I know now exactly what where your road is there that you're talking about, Ken. I mean, years back, the county is responsible. Kenny Nelson was there, Roy was there. They filled in, fixed that pipe up, and it used to go down to the old, not benefit, but. Peabody place, and it is established and built up in pipe section line. There are Archie Warner's does go in there quite often, but at the end of the day, I mean, this where this is blowing out, if somebody comes with a four-wheeler and rolls and gets hurt, or worse yet, we're going to be nailed with it. I mean, it's our road. You can't just shut it off. We've had claims when Gary was on, we had claims of guys cutting in the ditch and caught a washout up there. So this is on the main roadbed. Plus there's 3-4 farmers that do go there. Plus, like you said, Ken, it is what we used to call the old fire access road. You have to come through Warner's over there or the old Hulk place, but that's the only way we can get through between the two districts down in there because the Knife River cuts us off.
Is there any homes or any kind of...
They flagged it.
Has it been the same individual locking it all the time?
Probably.
Well, that I know of, yeah. And when I confronted him...
About this a few times over.
Yeah.
When I confronted him, he had said he had locked it to a mile to the south. Well, my blade operator is not going to go south on that. I mean, it's an unimproved trail.
Right.
Grassed in pretty good, but you know, so I don't know. Well, next time I talk with Dean or you, and
yeah.
Right,
I told him that you
because
can't lock it.
It can't be locked.
Right.
No. So.
Well, there's some work that needs to be done to fix that washout. I suggest we get it fixed.
Well, like I said, it's access to that state property back there, and you know. And it is. I mean, we've improved it. It's piped. It's just unfortunate that a big wash came through there. But it's one of those things. There's 3-4 guys that operate land back there, and that's kind of what we've done. So.
What's that?
I will just need a couple of those a year.
What do you think, Ken? I mean.
Well, I mean, other than you know. I guess it's kind of a fine line there. We talk about like the crossing north of Golden Valley, but yet yet there's only one individual that has property there, but where this has state land, and you got three, four owners, but there's kind of, I mean, it dead ends, I mean, it eventually ends, you can't go anywhere. So, I mean, it gets to the point where it's like, well, we look at our county road declaration, and we have no, to improve or upgrade section lines, so it's kind of a fine line, or what, you know what I'm saying, we're trying to push it off one individual, not saying, because that, it dead ends, or you can't go any further, but this kind of, you know, and we, it says in there, any improvements to section lines has to be upon the landowner, or whoever wants to improve it, so where's that fine line, I guess, is my question, where do we start drawing the line?
I agree, I think we have to be very careful so we don't start precedents.
Well, that's just it, I mean.
And treat everyone alike, you know.
And I mean, what is improving, is it, you know, a couple loads of dirt, or, you know, you start putting pipe in there, and you start adding, it starts tallying up pretty good.
Well, ultimately, it's always at your guys' discretion, and it's the same.
And that's why I brought it for, to, because I don't want to set a precedent.
Yeah, it's the same but different factors and whatnot, so ultimately.
And I agree with Wayne that there's state land back there, and the fact that, you know, the public can go back there, and they're supposed to be able to hunt and use that.
Right.
And.
But we're not.
Compared to the other one isn't, but when it's locked in the fall of the year, it kind of makes a guy wonder why it's locked in the fall of the year, is it a private preserve back there, or what is it, you know what I mean?
Well, right, we gotta get those issues resolved, but the big issue is this still falls under the fire district, and is my concern, I'm on that board, and there's guys from the Gold Valley Board, we, when Ken, back in Kenny Nelson and Art, well, he says Archie Warner sometimes can't get the semis out the other direction, this is the only way that poor man can get his cattle out of there, he's gotta go down that section line, load up and go out, and he's from south of Hebron, he owns a big parcel of the ranch over there from, Connolly's, right? Yeah, so it's not that these guys don't own any property, there's other than just hunting here, this is to provide service to those landowners and to the public that we got a lot of acres that could burn if we can't get in there. Plus, you're opening up again, a big opening, if this thing isn't flagged or barricaded or something, somebody, I wouldn't know, anybody could drive down there to side by side and wham, it's growing over, here we roll our side by side or worse yet. So we gotta be careful, that's all I can say.
Anything else, Ken?
No.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Thanks.
Well, we have a few minutes until the next item. Landfill tonnage report, that looked good to me. NDSU extension highlights, you can review those yourself and in your spare time. Salary discussion. I guess Shannon needs to know where we're at with
in your commission budget packets, I have a spreadsheet in the front of all the expenditures and all the revenues for every single account. In the department heads who did request anything for salaries, I kept the salaries at what they were last year, and I also kept the FICA, Medicare, and Social Security and retirement the same as last year, which would indicate a zero increase across the board this year, because I have no direction of what to put into those numbers. So when you look at the total expenditure for like the general fund, the $6.5 million, that's pretty much keeping everything the same, except for unless the department has added extra, but I didn't account for any of the FICA, Medicare, or Social Security, or retirement. in order the way it's gonna be on the agenda next week, so don't shuffle your papers.
What are the numbers in yellow?
Those are the ones I haven't received budgets for yet.
That have what?
That I haven't received a budget for.
Okay.
So I just put the revenue and expenditure the same, and I do believe they will be the same anyway. Well, unorganized road and aid to secondary roads is gonna be whatever we levy for, but the rest of them, the revenues will match the expenditures.
You didn't receive a budget from the water board yet?
They usually bring it in the day of their meeting.
Oh, 'cause I know it's done.
Yeah. And I did receive ambulance boards, I stuck in your packet yesterday, but I had already printed all these sheets, I didn't update this sheet.
Yeah, we had a special meeting Monday night and we redid the budget there, so they sent the new one.
With a nice hefty increase.
Well, we tried to cut it wherever we could, but I don't know if we can.
And the revenue side of it is using the taxes that were levied last year. So where you see the top line is mobile home and real estate taxes on the revenue side, that would be not increasing any taxes this year. That's using the revenue that we have already set. So if anybody wanna give me some direction on where to go with the salaries?
So what's the shortfall between the revenue and expenditures?
$1 million.
Have you called, what are the other counties doing as far as increases or anything?
Some of them are going with 2%. If they didn't give increases last year, some of them aren't giving increases. And some of them just always stick with their step increases.
But there were a lot of counties that didn't increase at all last year, right?
Right.
Well, you know, the 6.5 and 5.5 on revenues, you take that, what we amended this winter from last year's budget, that was 800,000, so it kinda, to me, it's adding up.
Right. And on the bottom there is where I have estimated transfers out. That's where you get the transfer out number for the general fund of 780,000?
Seven hundred and thirty.
730,000. Those are the accounts that would be short money, that need money from the general fund to fulfill their budgets.
For now? I mean...
For 2019. Those are the accounts we transfer money into every year. The totals just fluctuate.
Social services, how did you do that?
We don't do social services. They're not a social service.
Yeah, that's right, they do that.
Not, yeah. Basically not this, it's a two-year...
A two-year deal, yeah.
Two-year project there, but that's where it's gonna go from here.
I can't levy for social services.
No, you can't, no.
This...
But since you're talking about salary discussion, I just would like a little bit of direction, or we can leave it as is for now, or...
Well, we need to work on something.
This 2930 technology, Shanna, is that the fund where we took money to pay Vanguard? So there's nothing in there now, or?
That, it's just in the general fund, so there'll be money left over in it from this year to start the cash on hand next year.
And you did go up to 1.4 million on the...
Yep.
So that's a 14% increase.
Yeah.
And if you want the water board's budget, I can get it sent over here if you want.
It's okay. That one I just levy what they have on their sheet.
That's generally all they do, is they bring it the day of the meeting.
I don't know where it's gonna come from.
But can I get some direction on salaries for direction 30?
Well, I see you went, I take it the average,
yep,
brought it down to 472, 500 bucks
uh-huh.
a year for raises. But I can talk talk to you about this afterwards, but this is the one in 2016. This is the plan that we went with for the 17 budget.
Yep.
And it has all the percentages on the side, and everybody got 2% last year, so actually the ones that weren't at 100% on this should only, it should only be 3% for the ones that ain't on at 100%, because everybody got 2% last year.
Right, and we should go to 95 or 90%.
This brought everybody to 95%.
Okay.
And we got a two, everybody got a 2% last year, so everybody should be at a minimum of 97%.
Right. Do you want to just swing by my office after? We
can yes.
And we can visit about salary discussion at the beginning of my meeting. I start off on Tuesday morning with you guys. We can visit then. It'll give me a week to finalize my budget.
Not much direction for you, is there?
No.
I don't know. I don't know what to say about salaries. It seems we've got departments that cut every year, and then there's the same departments that's up every year.
Well, I guess I'd like to see them get a little bit, but we got $900,000 shortfall, you can't do that either, you know.
Well, this, some of these special funds, that's crazy. I don't know how we can keep on afford to doing some of that stuff.
Well, that's, a lot of that stuff we're going to take a close look at when we have our budget meetings with a lot of them, that's why I wouldn't mind almost kind of going through that first before we do the wage.
It would help.
This is kind of backwards. Would that work?
Yeah.
Because I think we can do some cutting in a lot of these areas. I think people are just going to have to start cutting, and then we might have enough to do a little bit of a wage increase. I hate to commit to a wage increase now, and then really have that shortfall. So I guess the wage to me should be last.
There's another $100,000 in that parks and lieu of fund. That's not included in any of our expenses either.
Well, I had covered that, Dwight, and
we'll
have to see what we can do there when we have our budget discussion. I made it a point to have maybe not all of it, but some money in there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I sure hope so.
Well, that was my intention.
Yeah.
But if you're, we can talk about
that. That ain't going away.
No. Well, past 10:30 here. Carmen, you're up next.
Hey, Carmen, before you get started,
yes.
I talked to the water board at the last meeting, and they would like you to come to the meeting on August 8th at 2 o'clock and present these whatever you want to call them, because expressed some interest in the flooding portions of.
Cool. I will do that. August 8th, 2 p.m. at the
law
you guys
office.
Always,
law
yeah, office. Got it. Okay. I will be there.
Sorry for the interruption, but I just,
no,
before I forgot.
That's good. I'm glad they're interested.
Okay, we have your budget review, Carmen, is that?
Yes. And really, okay, so you guys, I really didn't have any increases or nothing really changed.
like on the 911, the only thing that went up is training, and that was only because $2,000 I added because we have dispatcher online training. We found some really good, because we haven't found a good dispatcher training specifically for them, and now we have. So they go online every month, they get two new calls, they review, and it really teaches them a lot about 911 calls. So really, like, if we're looking at 911 budget, that's the only increase I had, was $2,000 for training. Otherwise, everything else pretty much stayed the same.
You actually decreased your 911 budget by 2,001% overall.
Overall, okay, and that's because I had $35,000 from the 911 equipment, and like last 2017, I only spent $24,000, so I downed it to $30,000.
Your salaries are increased, right?
But I did not put salary in there, so I guess my salary would be the same for this year.
That's because she split that half EM and half 911.
Oh.
Yeah, my salary split between the two.
Pencil on the auditor recommendation column is my handwriting.
This one over here?
Yeah, and the only thing I did on anybody is if they didn't put the salaries in, I just put their same salary.
The health insurance
stays the same.
Yeah, the 911 pays for all of my health insurance. It doesn't get split between the EM. Because when we started this, when Monty was here, that's the way he wanted to do it. So 911 pays for all of my health insurance. So it doesn't come out of the general fund, it comes out of the 911.
Which sustains itself.
It sustains itself,
it
yes.
It does not have any
yes,
tax
it does.
Dollars.
So what is the number from last year compared to this year? Last year's your budget was 140?
Nope. Wait, go down to 2911 under special funds on that spreadsheet I gave you. Just
last year, my budget, okay, this year for 2018, my budget was $210,621. And then I don't know what.
And then this year it's $208,621.
So it actually went down.
Yeah, $2,000 or 1%. She decreased 911 by 1%.
What is, on the last page, there's the three of them?
Yes.
What is that transfers out?
That is going into my equipment fund. I have to be setting money aside for this next generation 911. So we do that every year to build up that equipment fund. So when the time comes for us to purchase this next generation equipment, money to pay for it.
And how much money is in that fund? Or?
It's on your financial sheet.
So that's every year?
Yeah, I think last year we didn't get it moved over.
$51,000 is in there.
Okay, all right. So now this year, 2008, at the end of the year, we'll transfer $20,000.
Yep.
Is there a chance of doing any cutting there? I mean, what
well,
are you?
Well, okay, here's the thing. If we don't put money aside for the 911 equipment, we just end up paying for it anyway. And what we've done way in the past when I first started was the general fund gave the 911 a loan, and then every year I would pay back to the general fund as funds, you know, were there. So remember, my 911 fund is separate from your general fund.
Right.
It's basically everything Oliver County pays us and the 911 surcharge, the phones.
Well,
so
all the fees that is collected is all the money you got to work with.
Right, for the 911. And
yeah.
Thanks to Oliver County, we can sustain it. I truly believe they're the ones who allow us, because, you know, they've got 911 fees and they do take out of their general fund because they don't get enough 911 fees. So right now, I think my balance at the end of the year with the 911 has been pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we can transfer, we're able to transfer the $20,000 into our equipment fund and still have funding for my budget.
Is it getting more difficult getting grant money? I mean, is that something that's going to...
911, I don't get grant money for.
Okay.
But EM, yeah.
Is that something we might be hit up in the future, having to pay an RN more so if you don't get the grant money?
Well, right now, we are operating on that EMPG fund, and I know, we are getting another one next year. So, and basically, the way we have it set up with Oliver County and myself, that EM budget, pretty much everything, half of it is paid by the state. And what isn't paid by the state, another part of it's paid by Oliver. So we, maybe a quarter of EM budget is paid actually from the general fund. Everything else, I either get back from Oliver or I get back from state. So we are sitting pretty good with our EM. So, but other grants, you know, usually I find them, like the Oliver Sheriff's Office just got a Homeland Security grant for laptops, okay? Any of those grants are usually for the fire departments, law enforcement, or someone else, but not necessarily anything that I'm doing. Because everything that I'm doing right now is basically covered by that EMPG grant. You can't have more than one grant on a project.
How many years do you anticipate putting money aside for, like
for the equipment for 911?
Yeah.
Okay, the thing is, right now, this next generation software is new. Bismarck, Dickinson, the big four, they've got it installed, they're having some problems with it. I want to wait till they get it all situated. Right, when I checked into it last year, it would cost us initially like about $135,000 just to get started. And then they had a pretty large monthly fee, but then they had these issues. So we want to wait, and I'm hoping that whatever equipment we go with, we are going to be part of a bigger system. That's the good thing about next generation, because it's all computer, digital, so it's going to be a lot. So it should be cheaper. So I want to wait till they get the bugs worked out, and then we'll decide. But I gotta have a minimum of, I'm looking at least $150,000, what I'd like in that equipment fund before we start.
So it's gonna take a few years yet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless we decide at the end of the year we can put more in. You know, I try to keep track of it at the end of the year how much I have, and you know. But right now $20,000 is something that I know we can handle. We can put it aside, and I still have the money for the regular.
How long is the contract with Oliver County good for?
5 years.
5 years?
Yes.
And
we just got that signed.
We just signed that.
We just signed it this year.
And that's for sure money. I mean, there's no step or...
Nope. It's set. It's set. 911 coordinator, I'm set. $48.35 an hour, and then they pay, like I said, one sixth of the equipment and half of anything to do with the office for 911 side of it. Same with EM side of it. I'm set at that $48.35 per hour, plus the 1/6 and 1/2 with the office, and then 100% of whatever's specifically their work.
Right, we still pay for. Dispatch.
Okay, dispatch. Now remember, that's sheriff's side of it. That's not in my budget.
Oh, that is.
That's sheriff's side of it. They bill them. They get it directly. That's $40,000 into the sheriff's office.
Okay.
Per year for 5 years.
Okay, we'll have to wrap this up here. We have a public hearing at 10:45.
I only have one more thing. Carmen, when these negotiations are ongoing with other counties, I was wondering if it wouldn't be a bad idea to have a commissioner there.
Okay, what?
Well, like your negotiations for 911, that was good for 5 years, so there won't be nothing there. But I'm gonna bring it up with the sheriff's department too when they negotiate for how they cost share 911, radio services.
Okay, well, I know initially, okay, because you gotta remember this 5-year thing was new, and that was this year.
Right.
And basically, that was between the sheriff and their commission, and they made that deal. Okay, initially, the two sheriffs, it was always between the two sheriffs that actually put the two together. And Mercer County commissioners were not involved. I mean, they agreed, and the sheriff let them know about it. They didn't have a problem with it. You were there, weren't you? But the commission never wanted to go in that.
I think as long as they report back to us, you know.
Well,
but
the reason I brought it up is because Oliver County Commission made the suggestion that maybe
a commissioner.
If they're negotiating with commissioners on that end, there should probably be commissioners.
So what you're saying is that when it comes up in the 5 years, then we should have a commissioner involved in the 5 years.
Well, that or any other joint county function, you know.
Well, right now, this is the only joint county we got.
I know.
Not looking for any more. But yes, absolutely. I got no problems with that at all.
We'll have to call this short here. We have a public hearing, 10:45.
Thanks, Carmen.
Thanks, Carmen.
Any other questions?
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, Sarah, you're up. We'll close the regular meeting. And
I make a motion to close it.
Second.
Second. Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
Dwight?
What are we doing now?
Closing the regular meeting.
Just opening the public hearing.
I'll vote aye.
Now I'll vote aye. Motion carried. Sarah, you're up.
Planning any detours for those county roads or what?
Since the county road 15 would still stay open.
Right.
So there, we actually wouldn't be closing or affecting anywhere that has developed public access.
The only thing you would affect is that section line that used to use going through, and that's already closed, so.
This, well, this pink one here you're talking about, that's not closed, that's what the request is for, but it's an undeveloped section line.
Yeah.
Basically, it's just a barbed wire fence for the section line.
What about the diagonally solid line?
This, that would be the approved closure from previous years. That is the, there's a gravel ranch road, a lot of the local people call it, or a cross road.
That's what I was referring to, not the section line, I guess.
Oh, gotcha, yes, so it would be near there.
Yeah.
But that's already been closed.
That will no longer exist, there's no detour for it, or?
No, what was handled at that, or what was, I guess, agreed upon at that road closure that happened, it would have been last year, but I think the year before, when county agreed to that road closure, was there's a gate right here that has, a metal gate that has a lock on it, and then this road kind of continues on. This was the old McKellar place that's no longer occupied. There's a improved gravel road that comes out here, and there's also a locked gate, a gate that prevents public access. So this gravel road would either turn or would continue on, it kind of winds its way down to the Zap Road, I guess. And access into all these closed roads, there's metal gates with padlocks, and then anyone that grazes, farms, anything back in there has keys to get back in there. And none of that would really be affected by any of this, but it does relate to the general activity of the area.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the petition to close the public road on the section line between.
Do that after we close the public hearing and get back to it.
Oh, okay, okay.
Any other questions for Sarah on either the closure of the road or the setback waiver?
No, yeah, getting back to setback waivers, how, is it like X amount of feet off a right of way? Is that how it is?
Well, typically, yeah, we're required to stay 100 feet back from, like, say, a section line right of way.
Uh-huh.
And then we would submit these requests if we don't actually disturb the road, or the road doesn't need to be closed, but we want to get within that setback distance. So it's a variance from that required setback. So, like, in this situation here, there's an easement around this
corner. Right.
Yeah, and we kind of waived, do we request this variance to get close, and we looked at it, and it's like, kind of makes us nervous anywhere. There's a chance that someone swings 20 feet out too far, and now we're aren't in compliance with that setback. So it kind of helps give us, we're legally allowed to be in that area. We don't have any plans to, for example, there's a barbed wire fence that follows this curve around, and we aren't going to get within the road ditch, or that fence will stay in place, and we aren't going to take down the fence or cross the fence, for example.
Yeah, you're probably going to be 100 feet.
Yeah, like from the road, I guess I didn't measure, I don't know the exact distance.
That particular road is 75-foot setback on that 15 road. Then in that corner, we bought that corner out, so that probably, that goes quite deeper, you know.
Sure. Yeah.
So I just wanted to clarify how close that is, you know, to our.
I don't know the exact distances, but looking at this purple area, about the closest point our disturbance plans would be to get within the road would be at that corner.
Uh-huh.
I'm not sure I'm going to visually estimate the distance, but I can see on the aerial photo where the fence line runs, and it's definitely well, you know, outside of that.
Outside.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Sarah? Thank you.
Thanks.
And we can need a motion to close the public hearing and open the regular meeting.
So moved.
Is there a second? I vote aye. I will do this, I think, in two separate motions. Take the petition to close the public road first.
Yeah, I guess I'll make that motion now.
I'll second it.
Wes, how do you vote?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Wayne?
I'll vote aye.
And I vote aye, motion carried. Now a motion on the setback waiver petition.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Wayne, how do you vote?
I'll vote aye.
Wes?
Aye.
Dwight?
Aye.
Gary?
Aye.
And I vote aye, motion carried. Thank you. Yeah, we just have a one item, portfolio updates to, pardon?
And the job posting, that's the way we're going to talk about.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, how do you come about with internal and external? The job opening here for the tax collector, it was never posted externally, but now this time for your assistant, it is external and internal at the same time.
I wanted mine internal and external at the same time. I didn't feel that anybody would step down into a secretary position from their positions around here, so I posted it both internal and external. I'd like to get somebody in and trained before we start up with election right away again.
So why, what was the decision not to go external with the tax director job?
It was a department head position, and there might have been other, I mean, they could have done external, but I think Cindy had expressed interest right away. So you have to allow for, you have to interview, you don't have to, but if there's qualifications, if they're qualified, you have to give them a chance as internal, you know, so we knew that we have one internal, and then if that one didn't work out, then we could have went to the streets with it afterwards. And I'm fine with whatever direction you guys give me. If you want them all in, if they say that you're supposed to post it, the policy says internal for 7 days prior to posting it externally. But I didn't think anybody internal would apply for my office, so they just put it external right away.
Well, I'm just asking, so I'd like to see some consistency in these job openings.
Okay, I can do that. I should have left mine internal for 7 days before I sent it to job service, but.
Well, effectively though, if you get external and you get internal, you wouldn't consider the external until you consider the internal, right?
Right, yeah. It's a way of speeding up your process to, so you don't have such a time lapse. But it could be both, done both, as you were saying. Internal.
And I guess that's something that the policy committee could look at.
Yeah.
I'd also like them to look at the interview questionnaire. The thing is from like the 1970s and it's completely outdated.
Yeah, I was really disappointed in that. There was not one question on there that pertained to the job. Not one.
That's the standard one that the county used for years. So I don't know. I don't know how you guys want to do it. If you want to have department heads write their own interview questions for each department, and then the board can approve them, and that's the standard form for each department, or what? But we have to remember we have veterans' preference, which is why it's a number system. So.
Now, could have somebody from internal applied for your position?
At the same time.
The same time here?
Yeah.
And if they're more qualified, they get the position over an external employee.
They have to meet a minimum qualifications.
Yeah.
Is that it, Dwight?
Yeah.
Well, just that if we need to do something to get it more consistent, and if we need to come up with interview questions that pertain to the job, because I had some questions, but I was told I couldn't ask them.
Well, we tried
pertaining to the job.
Well,
how else are you going to know minimum qualifications if you don't ask about the job?
The board's not going to know what questions to ask because they don't know what that department head does. So it's going to be best if the department head itself writes the questions and then it goes through.
about everybody knows what the tax director's job involves.
Well, broadly probably, but not the little details.
Well, no.
So.
Okay, we'll take a look at doing something different there. Last item we have is the portfolio updates. Wes?
I really don't have anything. We're gonna have planning and zoning meeting tomorrow night. Other than that.
Eric? I don't have anything.
Dwight?
Water board, Basin Electric presented their new drainage system for the Lee Old site. That was approved by the water board. We did get a letter. I don't know if you've all got it or not, but Cindy did, with this new development coming up. The water board has decided that they would like any new development to provide a system to manage their own stormwater. Because this new development up there definitely will affect Lakeshore's issues. Now, I can bring this to the planning and zoning meeting tomorrow night if I have to for this request, but I don't think I should have to.
No, Dwight, I got a copy of that letter, and I actually, with the developer, I visited him with him earlier, and I asked him to get together with the water board because of the issues up there. So I think we do have to take a close look at it and see what we've got to do so we don't multiply the problem.
Well, as it stands right now, it's securely degraded the negotiations between the people involved up there and the water board. So there's a good chance that project could not get done because of this subdivision.
I think my thought on that is I'd like to have the developer come to your water board meeting, visit with you.
I think we need to talk about the planning and zoning tomorrow where it's on the agenda. We'll put the cart before the horse here.
It's in my portfolio.
I understand
the water
that, but
board.
It's also a pending application, so I don't think you should be giving any opinions about it until everything's been heard. Because it'll come back to this board, at which time you guys can address
We don't
whatever.
See the preliminaries. All
no,
we see is the
finals.
Eventually
the final comes here, yes.
And
so
then it's
you
too
can
late.
Have input if you want to go to the planning and zoning, fine, but I don't think you guys will be hearing or making any kind of decisions or anything about it until it's been heard.
Okay, moving on. Dwight, do you have anything else?
Nope.
Wayne?
Not a whole lot, but as I said, or you seen the bill that four-wheeler, they had started to create huge issues, and so they were able to get that traded and updated, and they did look at their budget pretty hard to see, if they were able to find sustain that amount, and it looked like they discussed it and worked on it, and it looked like they could pencil it out. And then, of course, getting a little bit back, the other part, the airport, we had our fly on here the other day on Saturday, I think it was the 7th. Weather was a little bit on the warm side, so the plane numbers were down a little bit because barometric pressure and being warm condition, it gets tricky on flying. But we had a very good turnout. We didn't really do the numbers yet. We'll catch that next meeting here. But very successful and event. And I thank folks tremendously for coming out. We also had an ambulance call at the same time that we're trying to get the sausages and the sausages are done, but the pancakes, but we managed, we helped her out, and life went on, and went good. We had excellent turnout for individuals, we had one of three planes, I believe, giving rides, and we gave rides till we were done, and so that was about 1-something, 1:30 maybe, and very, very good attendance. We're very pleased with that. We have a pre-contract for our taxiway. They met the other day, so this is ongoing. So hopefully, I'm not sure when he's going to move in there, but by the end of the summer, we'll have a new taxiway in front of the hangars going there. And the beacon will have to be moved, and the board directors will move that and save costs. And the other part is, I believe that our budget is in, but I know we dropped the mills a little bit on the airport.
You did good.
Yeah, I was glad to see that. So that'll help.
Oh, yeah, move the beacon.
It's right, it's in the way.
Oh.
Yeah, it's part of it. It's just going to be south of it. And I think I talked long enough.
I don't have much. The landfill's doing okay. Ambulance board, I did mention we had a special meeting last Monday night, specifically about the budget. We'll hear about it when they come next week. We have a regular ambulance board meeting next week, Monday evening at 6 o'clock in Beulah. That's all I have. I think that's it for the agenda.
Budget meetings next week.
Yep, okay. Budget meetings starting at 9 o'clock on Tuesday.
See you then. Meeting adjourned.
Put your packets out of order.
Bring them later.
Okay, Tuesday and
Tuesday.
Tuesday and Wednesday.
Tuesday and Wednesday.